Well, actually, Dave was one of the few people with equipment. And that's, there you go.
You know, One for the Treble, when I found out that, you know, it was Davy's record and that he was doing virtually everything on it, didn't surprise me.
Time out, bro. Davy D did Beats to the Rhymes and Runs Out. Yo, son.
We wish we, I didn't have that drum machine yet. I didn't have any equipment.
This is where I met Run DMC and Russell Simmons. I was doing this center right here, the after school center. Ten for the
best. I started realizing this Davy D is the same cat my brother was telling me about that had the little DJ crew that would DJ around Queens Village. Ten for the bag, ten for the bag.
On the DMX drum machine and the scratches. Come on, Davy D, come on, Davy
D, let's rock this place. No, I could have been one of the DJs.
Oh, you
could have
been
that
DJ?
Yeah, I
could have
been a DJ, but after Curtis Blow.
So, like, to this day, I think about him every time, like, I'm on the road or we're driving somewhere.
Hey Google, play Have You Seen Davy?
Have You Seen Davy by Davy DMX? Sure.
I didn't know he played. He's a real musician.
Sounds like precursor to Beastie Boy shit.
I tried to play the guitar.
Doesn't it? Sounds like a Beastie Boy record.
It was the flyest, I don't know if I can curse, but it was the flyest shit to me.
Then there was no real blueprint. There was no blueprint, so everything that they were doing was very innovative.
Davy is very unsung among producers and DJs.
But we all would wait for Dave to go to band practice so somebody could get on the turntables.
I remember Russell bringing me the Orange Crush, and I'm not sure if it said Dave's name on it or Dave had something to do with it, you know, or he played bass or something. I'm not sure exactly what it was. So I was like, I didn't know that Dave was even a musician, you know, like I thought he was just a DJ, you know.
Yo, here we are. It is Friday again. I'm Jeremy Beaver, CEO and founder of Listen Vision and the Hip Hop Museum, with my DJ, the one, the only,
B-Dub the Boy Wonder.
Hey, what's up, B-Dub?
How are you, sir? Happy Friday to you.
Happy Friday to you. The weather has distinctively turned cold.
Yes.
We don't have seasons anymore.
Not at all.
It's just hot and cold.
That's it. That's all you get.
And now it's cold. That's right. We have an amazing show today because our guest, Davy DMX, is behind some of the biggest groups and records in hip-hop of all time.
Yes.
Okay.
Got
so you got Curtis Blow, the Fat Boys,
Run
DMC. Public Enemy, and his own stuff.
Yes,
and his own stuff.
Definitely.
So stay tuned. Right after our news segment, we are going to have one of the most prolific and influential hip-hop producers and musicians and DJs of all time.
And I found out he did the song to my favorite movie, Crush Groove.
Oh, that's right. He did Crush Groove, but he also did Sucker MCs. Yeah. You know, like just so many tracks. Okay, so stay tuned. In just a little bit, this amazing guest, Davy DMX, will be with us. But right now, we have a section of the show that we lovingly refer to as Today in Hip Hop. Okay, there we go. We did it. All right, get my little sidebar going. And I would like to, get rid of the reverb. And let's get right into a brand new Tribe Called Quest art show. So this is really dope. This is happening at the Philly Art Collective Gallery on January 18th. And I think this is like the third or fourth time they've done this, but this is an entire art show, free event, dedicated to A Tribe Called Quest. So go check that out if you're in the Philadelphia area. Another great show, and I love all these great hip-hop shows that are happening at Sony Hall, is Big Daddy Kane coming to Sony Hall on January 2nd. I guess that's the day after New Year's. If you're not too hungover, go check out one of my favorite rappers of all time, Big Daddy Kane. And speaking of people that are fashionable. Big Daddy Kane is a very fashionable dude. There's an incredible exhibit happening right now about black fashion. So let's see. Of course, I took a terrible screen capture here. So this is the 1990s groundbreaking. This new exhibit celebrates its rise through the company Cross Colors. Let's go to the next one. I think it explains. Yeah. All right. If we could zoom out just a little bit, I'm going to read this to you because it's really incredible how this one company has kind of been able to trace the history of hip-hop fashion. The 21st century platforms such as Instagram have made it easier than ever before for businesses to exercise direct-to-consumer advertising with each swipe through the app's algorithm. Countless influencers and advertisers benefit from the eyes of their products, but before technology made this kind of advertising practically omnipresent, brands relied on more traditional methods such as product placement. In 1990, when Will Smith's vibrant comedy and wardrobe appeared in living rooms across the country during the first season of The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, the Los Angeles-based clothing brand worn by the lead actor was catapulted to stardom. Cross Colors, founded by designers Carl Jones and TJ Walker just the year before, became an instant commercial success. Next slide. In celebration of the pioneering apparel line and its enduring legacy, the California African American Museum has mounted an exhibit that chronicles the brand's 30-year history. And let's go to some of these pictures just real quickly, DZ. And in fact, we even have some Cross Colors on set with us. Look at this incredible exhibit with the fashion and the images and the logos of the brand that I wore to no end. I had everything Cross Colors in the late 80s and early 90s. This is a really great exhibit. And here's some more images actually from fashion of... is that it? Okay, those were those two images. But this is right now at the... Huh? No, that's fine. This is the California African American History Museum, which is chronicling black fashion through Cross Colors, just like this vintage 1989 jersey that we have on set from Cross Colors. Okay. In other amazing news, Black Thought will be teaching the first ever hip-hop course at Carnegie Hall. That's right. The vocal leader of the Roots to teach the very first ever hip-hop class at Carnegie Hall. Everything that I've been reporting on, this is all really big historical stuff because, you know, hip-hop's been considered so counterculture for so long. I believe that the hip-hop museum and everything we're doing is just now starting to kind of celebrate it, whereas, you know, we've been kind of like living it for 40-odd years. Now we're starting to commemorate it, and that's really nice. Here's the coolest, weirdest poster I found in a long time. Shout out Dan Lish with his Ego Morph poster. Look at what happens when rappers morph into aliens.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Dude, and look at Big Pun. Look at Big Pun. This is hilarious. Thank you, DZ, who moved at center screen. Look at Fat Joe becomes like the lady from the fish under the sea thing. Ludacris becomes a lion. Big Daddy Kane becomes Groot. This is... I really love... Oh, look, Action Bronson becomes the Cowardly Lion.
So who's Beetlejuice? Who's that ODB?
Wait, where do you see that? ODB becomes Beetlejuice.
Oh, wow.
Oh, that's great. Snoop Dogg becomes some sort of elf from The Dark Crystal. Oh, my God. Will Smith becomes Wallace and Gromit. Right, that's Fat Joe. Fat Joe becomes Ursula. Oh, he is the most creative.
I am Groot. I can't get over that.
Oh, my God. Who is that? Is that 50 Cent becoming Shrek?
Wow.
Whoa. What is that? Dr. Dre becoming Mastermind? Oh, my God. Dude, Will Smith becomes Gromit. This is very funny to me. Oh, my God. This is very... Wait. Ice Cube's becoming... What is that, Yoda? Who's that becoming Yoda? Oh, this is the best thing ever. Okay, go back. We're going to do the whole show on this next time. Oh, shout out Dan Lish. That was some good shit, dude. That's really funny. Also, shout out DJ Shadow, who just released his new album and has an amazing music video with for the lead single with De La Soul. And this video actually pokes fun at kind of like you know, mocking the moon landing. Do we have a screen capture of this video? Yeah. DJ Shadow's new single, Rocket Fuel, with De La Soul, is kind of like mocking the fake moon landing, if you think it's fake or whatever. All right. I love Egyptian Lover because I like everything 808. And he's actually released some new singles and videos with Nucleus. He did a new single with Nucleus, and then he did a whole nother one with Qbert. And those are all online right now. So go check out Egyptian Lover's new music. I don't know why I love everything he does. It's just electro is so cool to me. We were listening to it in the office all day long, electro music. Eric B., of Eric B. and Rakim fame, was jailed for a 17-year-old warrant where his attorney, who was later convicted and jailed of murder himself, told Eric B. not to show up. Don't worry about it. We got it. 17 years later, the producer, DJ turned actor, was arrested, and he's since been let out. But we're following that story. Here's a great picture from Charlie Stettler, who I've been talking and working with, the Fat Boys' old manager, of the Fat Boys in East Germany. This is a really historic image because if you understand the timing of this, the Fat Boys were the first and only hip-hop group to ever make it into communist East Germany before the wall came down. And that's kind of like a big, amazing historical fact. Because, like, nobody was going to East Germany in the same way that nobody, you know, no rappers are doing concerts in North Korea. Hey, shout out my graffiti brother out in the Netherlands, Oustem One. Look at this incredible Gangstar mural that he's done for their new album, one of the best yet. And there's a new video that's out featuring Guru's son for their newest single. But shout out Oustem One, who did this incredible, incredible mural. I love your work, dude. Keep it up. Keep up the great work. Also, I love the great work of DJ Toast on the Grown Man Rap Show. Just did an entire tribute to Dennis Coffey, the funkiest white man guitar player who's been sampled a zillion times by hip-hop hits endlessly. The Motown musician and guitar player Dennis Coffey, an entire dedication show for his 79th birthday by the Grown Man Rap Show. One of my favorite MCs, top three favorite MCs of all time, is KRS-One. Okay, Rakim, KRS-One, and Sean Price. Those are my three favorite MCs in no particular order. And he's got a new album out, and like nobody knows about it. And that's just so typical. So KRS-One has an amazing new album out. Well, amazing. It's awesome. It's very cool. It's very different than a lot of his other stuff. But it's really, really great. And it's called Streetlight? What'd that say, DZ? Jeez, I want to tell. Streetlight, yes. Streetlight. New album, Streetlight. Go check it out. It's on Bandcamp right now. Okay. Old School Explosion on November 23rd. Look at this lineup. What an amazing lineup. Slick Rick, Big Daddy Kane, Nice and Smooth, Houdini. And this is November 23rd in Tacoma, Washington at the Temple Theater. So go check that out. That's coming up just next Saturday. All right. And then I love this production DJ crew out in Germany called the Snow Goons. They've come up with a new collab. Look at those incredible Air Force Ones that have been customized. New Snow Goons apparel and sneakers. I think you get some vinyl. Yep, they got colored vinyl of the new Onyx single that they've done. So go check that out. The Snowmads. Yeah, good stuff, guys. Keep up the good work with the classic hip-hop. And speaking of classic hip-hop, coming to our area, B-Dub, we got Rakim coming to the Baltimore Soundstage on December 13th. What a great way to spend the holidays with your loved one. By listening to the Microphone Fiend. Okay, so go check out that show if you're in this area. And here's just a random picture that I think this is historic. So Red Bull is honoring Crazy Legs? I don't know. So Crazy Legs, the absolute hip-hop pioneer, breakdancing pioneer, is now on Red Bull cans, and that's just awesome. We're really finally starting to, you know, commemorate the legacy and the history of the music and culture of hip-hop. And speaking of the music and legacy and culture of hip-hop, rest in peace and also happy birthday. Today is ODB's birthday.
Oh, wow.
Okay, so happy birthday, ODB. That piece right there is by our creative director at the Hip Hop Museum, Andy Katz, the notorious KATZ, and it's signed by the entire Wu-Tang Clan. I was with him for the 25th anniversary of the 36 Chambers. Look at him with ODB's son, who signed the incredible piece of artwork. And also, RZA signed it. We were all backstage, and I ate the Wu-Tang symbol with Raekwon the chef. He also got it signed by Method Man. That's right. I love Method Man's hat right there. That's a Method Man hat. And I think I took some of these pictures. I'm not sure, but I know I was there with Andy the entire time. Got one more. Nope, that's it. So happy birthday and rest in peace. ODB passed away November 13th, 2004, 2 days before his birthday. So it's like RIP and happy birthday to ODB. On the 25th anniversary of DaShinin', Smith and Wesson is getting together to perform and commemorate this classic album. One of my favorite albums of all time, the song Soundboy Burial, is forever ingrained in my head. So is Duck Down and Bucktown and so many incredible Smith & Wesson singles. This album is truly a truly classic album. So go check that out in New York City. I think that was on the 9th of January. Okay, Take It Personal podcast, one of my favorite podcasts of all time, has done something I don't think they've done before. They have pitted Nas against Jay-Z. That's right, ages 45 and 49. Nas is 5'8", Jay-Z 6'2". One's from Queens, one's from Brooklyn. Mass appeal, Rock Nation. Got aliases, got debut albums, Illmatic and Reasonable Doubt. Weaknesses.
Is Khalees not both of their weaknesses? Well,
first of all, they put Becky, Solange, and Elevators as Jay-Z's weaknesses.
That is hilarious.
Okay, they should have put Money on there as well. And Fried Chicken Khalees and the New York... You guys are funny. Fila Flava and DJ 360, you guys never cease to amaze me. Great show. I'm about halfway through the four-hour show, so it's really great so far. And so far, Nas has won all the early rounds. The last piece of hip-hop news is that Yasiin Bey, I refer to him as Mos Def, I guess he prefers Yasiin Bey, will be at the Howard Theater on November 27th. That's just coming up the day before Thanksgiving. That's right. So if you want, your cousins are in town, your relatives are in town, you know, go check that out at the Howard Theater. Okay, but right now, we're going to go to a little break, and one of the most prolific DJs and producers in hip-hop of all time, Davy DMX, is going to be with us. So check out this trailer from his new documentary, and when we return, the one, the only, Davy DMX.
All right, let's call him up. Yeah, call him up.
Huh? One for the treble, no, two for the bass. Come on, Davy D, let's rock this place.
Yo, 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 and we are back. If you're just tuning in, I'm Jeremy Beaver, CEO and founder of Listen Vision and the Hip Hop Museum, with my DJ, the one, the only.
The Boy Wonder.
Oh, DZ, we got him? With my DJ. Oh, let's try this again. With my DJ, the one, the only.
B-Dub the Boy Wonder.
There we go. B-Dub the Boy Wonder is my DJ, and we are back with the one, the only, one of the most prolific and pioneering hip-hop DJs and producers and musicians of all time, Davy DMX. Thanks so much for being with us, friend.
Yeah, how you? Appreciate you.
Oh, good, good, good. Okay, let's get him a little turned up. And you look amazing, D. I just got to tell you, man, you do not age.
Thank you, man. Thank you. Hip-hop keeps you young.
Hip-hop does keep you young, especially when you're passionate about something.
Yeah, it's the only music that, you know, probably go through like 4 decades or something. I mean, so you just feed off the young energy.
Yeah, no, it's really true, because it's like hip-hop is so culture-based, not just musical-based, that it's like if you're not kind of like energetic, you know, nobody's interested, plain and simple.
Right.
Hey, but you know, we always start off our, you know, these are interviews that are kind of meant to be, you know, archival, you know, footage about who you are, your career, how you got started, all this type of stuff. And we, you know, we normally start off with a question that doesn't even apply to you. And the question is, you know, when did you first fall in love with hip hop? You go so far back, you damn near created the genre. Okay, so we're going to start with
first sight, man.
Right.
First sight.
So let's ask a different question. Okay. How and why, or what was it like growing up in West Virginia in the 70s?
Okay, you know, that's where my parents are from. So, you know, basically, they, you know, when I was born actually in Harlem.
Oh.
So, yeah, I was actually born in Harlem. And then moved to Queens in 1970. You know, I had a little uptown flavor, you know, just didn't kind of realize it, you know. I lived on the Lexington Avenue between 114th and 115th.
So, did you spend any of your childhood in West Virginia?
Okay, I started my first grade in West Virginia. You know, that's where my grandmother lived, and we, you know, went there every summer.
Oh, okay, I see.
I did first grade in West Virginia, and did the 10th grade in West Virginia.
So at what age did you, DZ, we lost his picture there. Hold on one second, Davy. So for you, what was it like, you know, being a kid that goes from, you know, the culture in the area of West Virginia to the culture in the area of Hollis, Queens? That seems like very different environments. Did we lose him, DZ? We lost him. Okay. We're getting Davy DMX back on the phone right now. We actually lost signal with him.
Are you there?
Yep, we're here.
One, two.
We lost you, but we got you back now. DZ, do we have visuals on him as well? Okay, we're getting you set up. Sorry, you know, this is welcome to the internet land.
This is
what happens. This is what can happen. We lost you, but we got you back, and we can hear you loud and clear. So tell me, my question was, what is that like going from the area and the culture of West Virginia to the area and the culture of Hollis, Queens? That seems like it'd be very different environments.
Well, I mean, you know, as a musician, you know, playing in the church and so forth, you know, it was always like a freedom to like kind of make your own little thing. So, you know, I'm like 13 or 14 years old. I was tired of like doing top 40. So, you know, I was trying to encourage my band to like, let's just make some original stuff. And people be playing our stuff just like we playing Earth, Wind & Fire, anybody, you know what I'm saying? So,
did I hear you say that you got started playing music in the church?
Well, actually, you know, I had little local bands and stuff like that, but, you know, for my bass style, it's definitely church, you know, church because it's runny, you know, basically from church.
And then, okay, so then at what point did you go from, you know, being a musician and playing instruments, not that you've stopped, But like, at what point did you get interested in DJing?
DJing, probably like 15. That's like 75. I had a cousin, Ronnie Woods, that had a pair. He had the first pair of turntables. You know what I'm saying? So I used to stop by school like every day, and you know, but it was more like club disco type of music, like Quartz, Cerrone, you know, that type thing. So I went up to the Bronx to my cousin's house, and then I saw Junebug at a club called 371 cutting a record, Groove to Get Down by T-Connection. And when he just cut it in, it just changed my whole life, you know what I mean? Like, because I was into mixing and blending and stuff like that, you know? So,
what year do you think that was?
Well, I'm going to say like 76.
76. So you're talking about, you're looking at scratching within only 1 or 2 years of its invention. Because we just had Grand Wizard Theodore on the show only just a few weeks ago.
Right. Yeah.
And that changed your life. I mean, you know,
it changed my life, but he really wasn't scratching, see, because to me, scratching was a word made up of what we did, because we was either mixing or cutting. So scratching, I don't know who made that word up, but it wasn't around when I was coming up.
So you went to the club, you saw Junebug cutting the record.
Yes, Junebug was DJ Hollywood's DJ. Do you know about him?
Oh my God, absolutely. You can't have a hip-hop museum without knowing DJ Hollywood.
Yeah, it's a club called 371.
And then, you know,
76.
You also had early dealings with Love Bug Starsky as well.
Love Bug Starsky, of course, Curtis Blow.
Yeah. Well, let's hold on. Slow down. We're going too fast. Going too fast. Okay. You got so much history. We would have to do like a 10-hour show on you.
Yeah.
Okay. So my question is, you were DJing a little bit, just regular mixing. You saw this DJ cutting, and then I have to ask you about this because you're really one of the very earliest turntablists, okay?
Right.
So that, you know, when you have you have Theodore, you have Grandmaster Flash, and you have, you know, DST or DXT, Grand Mixer DST.
DST, but Rocket, right?
Same right, DST. Exactly, from Rocket. So you guys are just the very, very earliest kind of like examples of turntablists. What made you want to start becoming like a musician on the turntables?
I was a musician, you know, because it's like you soloing to me, you know. When I first started, I looked at it as soloing. Matter of fact, I got this orchestra record, and that's another story. It's like,
okay.
Yeah, soon to come,
Okay, so you how did you link up with Larry Smith and form Orange Crush?
Okay, I was Curtis Blow's DJ. And Curtis Blow, after a while, wanted to have a band behind him. Well, at first, Curtis wanted, I was just hired temporarily to do like 3 or 4 gigs. And I ended up doing like 6 years with Curtis on the road. But when he decided to get a band, Larry Smith was the bass player. I play guitar. You had Trevor Gale on the drums.
Uh-oh. We lost.
How could I stop people from calling me? Like,
People call. Well, that's what happens when you're Davy DMX and you're connected with 2/3 of all of hip hop. No, but seriously, so you're already on tour with Curtis Blow when he asked to form a band with you guys?
No, so the band came with around Action, and you know. We're Curtis Blow's
band. It's okay. He's a popular guy. We can't be mad at popular. It's okay. We're not mad at popularity.
Right.
So when were you ever DJing for Curtis Blow, or were you only just a part of?
I started out DJing for Curtis Blow before the band, but because I was a musician, you know, I was able to transition and be the guitar player for the Orange Crush.
Okay, so this is a perfect transition. DZ, we have a video there, the very first video, Curtis Blow. It's called AJ meets Davy DMX, okay? So we're going to give people a little taste of what you were doing with Curtis Blow before the music in the band, okay? So hang with us. We're going to play, you know, because this is an educational show as well. It's not just about, you know, going through the history.
I'm all history.
You know, there's young people history. Who need to know, you know, their history. And so, okay, right. DZ, we got that video? Yeah, it's called Curtis Blow, and it's titled Number One. Okay, so here we go. This is called AJ, which was another DJ for Curtis Blow, meets Davy DMX, and they are, I guess, what is this, the first record where DJs battled each other? I don't know. On record.
Yeah, on record, probably. Probably.
This might be the first. I had never heard this before. All right, so check this out, everybody. Curtis Blow.
About the brother called AJ Scratch. There's not a beat that he can't catch. He's so deaf, he doesn't rehearse. And if you wanna see me, then he comes first. He's another DJ from Hollis, Queens. He's a disco dream on a mean machine. And I knew him ever since 78. And to the sucker DJs, I wanna set you straight. And now we're a trio and we're ready to rock. From the bottom to the top, we rock not stop. So bust the move of rap history when AJ Scratch meets Davy D.
I mean, Davy, as a young person, you're on tour, you're DJing for one of the biggest acts in America, if not the world, and now you're getting on his records. What was the feeling at the time?
Oh, it was an incredible jump going from like the park to the garden, I say, you know?
Did it feel like that? Kind of like an almost an overnight success type of
thing?
Yeah,
really. So, me DJing for Curtis, We did open up for the Commodores tour.
Wow.
I think it might have been their last tour. We got to see the whole world. I mean, the whole United States. The Commodores go where a lot of people don't go. You know,
wow.
We did the Madison Square Garden with Bob Marley, which was his last show as well.
Do you remember meeting Bob Marley?
Yes. Frankie Crocco, all of them was there. It was incredible.
That's a really surreal moment. Commodores,
right. That's
Bob
a story
Marley.
Itself.
I mean, you know, that's one of those moments that... what did that feel like?
It was kind of awesome, man. You know, like... I just took it as it came, you know what I mean? Because, you know, after growing up, you know, you got your parents here and you need to save all your money from this thing... You know, might not end up being around long. But like, wow.
Right. So you got to absorb.
I'm on the road with the Commodores, you know, and they had like Fatback Band, Chic, a Cameo, Larry Graham, you know. So, I mean, I was right there on the stage with these guys and, you know, watching their live shows.
But you're also involved, you know, in a genre of music at that time that's so brand spanking new.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? It's not just a matter of you sharing stage with all these legends. It's that you also have the balls, the gravitas, you know, to try doing musically something that's never really been done before.
Right. I worked with Cameo before, with Larry Blackman. You know, after being on the road with them, you know, on the Commodore store, you know.
So tell me,
we did a group called Cashflow. I did a song on Cashflow.
So when you formed the Orange Crush group, that music and the productions, the records that you guys created, While they may not have been, you know, commercially as successful as they wanted, they were culturally and significantly some of the most important recordings in the history of hip hop.
Well, you know, that takes this good musician. Tony Gale was a hell of a drummer, but he laid that track down in, like, for like 10 minutes.
right. You got to be like a human metronome, right?
A lot of drummers couldn't do it. I mean, we got Pumpkin after Trevor, and you know, he was close, but he wasn't Trevor Gale, you know.
So what were you playing bass in Orange Crush?
No, I was playing guitar.
So you were playing guitar in Orange Crush. So then
And DJing as well.
Oh, and DJing. So at what point, and this is the question I was most looking forward to asking you, at what point did you get your very first Oberheim DMX?
Let's say 82, 81.
And why?
Something like that.
Why?
81.
Why did you get it?
You know, because you always need a drummer. You have to wait for a drummer to come over.
So it was birthed out of, like, so you're already DJing, you're already playing in a band, and it seems to me, though, not just becoming your namesake as Davy DMX, but it also seems to me that when you got the Oberheim drum machine, you really were like, oh shit, I'm a one-man band. I can do this all myself.
Right.
Programming,
and, you know.
Is that how you felt? You're like, oh, shit, I just need this one other thing, and now I'm my own thing.
Right. I mean, you know, I play keyboards as well. So.
Right. Well, that's what one of the things that makes you so unique in hip-hop is that you're such a musician. You know, talk about jack of all trades. I mean, you have really, you know, guitar, bass, drum machine, DJing. Okay, so let's fast forward a little bit, just a tiny, tiny little bit, okay? So when we were in a break, I apologize to our viewers. We were not watching the movie trailer, which we played at the intro. We were actually watching One for the Treble, and it was like an original B-Boy dedication video. Now, One for the Treble, you know, is your first solo release, but it's not your first production. It's not your first production credit, right? We have in our history, because we have historians and we have questions to ask you from our historian, we have this record with Spoonie G being your first production credit, the big beat. Is that true?
Okay, yeah, that is. That's probably my first production, yeah.
All right, perfect timing. We have an incredibly rare Spoonie G performance back. Wow. I don't even know what year this might be, 82? Of the big beat on public access TV. I think this is actually via our historian, the Hip Hop Museum's historian, Jay Kwan. So let's check this out. This is Davy DMX's first production called The Big Beat with Spoonie G, one of the most, you know, iconic MCs in hip hop. Let's take a listen.
It's good as gold. You can feel it way deep down in your soul. Funky sound, it's world now. So come on, girl, let's get on down. Gotta do it right the weather day or night. You gotta rock to the beat with all your might. The moment has come for you to meet. Whatever makes your body move is the big beat. To see that it's meant to be for you and me in ecstasy, passion and pain, but a lot to gain. And the way you are, I hope you'll remain. With sex appeal, too good to be real, and it shows.
Man, I don't know if you could see that, but that was an incredible throwback video with Spoonie G. And if anyone knows anything about the Oberheim DMX, I mean, there's those iconic kicks and claps and everything like that. What was your feeling? You know, when you saw this on TV or when the record came out, like, holy shit, I'm producing my own records.
Right. But you have to know that Action.
Yeah.
Action's beat is Suck MCs with a DMX, with hand claps. Same exact pattern.
Right. And so, and in fact, the Action beat is actually the foundation for Sucker MCs, right?
Exactly.
Right, Crush Groove 1, 2, 3, and Part 17. <You know? laughs> You know, it's like, and that's what I was trying to trying to tell the people, you know, is that Davy DMX is living hip hop, like is hip hop, right? From that Orange Crush, the music you did with Orange Crush, amongst other things, weaves its way through so many things. You know, Crush Groove, the movie, one of the most iconic hip-hop movies, you know, of all time. Is there any relationship between the words Orange Crush and Crush Groove? Why do those...
You know, it's Russell Simmons, so, it probably did, you know.
And when did you meet Russell? Because Russell's a really integral part of this.
I met Russell... 77, 78.
Why? What were you doing?
Well, he lived in my neighborhood. I used to DJ at junior high school, 192. So that's where I actually met Run first.
Uh-huh.
I met Run first, and then I got to meet him, and then that's how I got to meet Curtis Blow, because he was managing him.
How much of Crush Groove, the movie, was accurate to what was going on with Def Jam label?
You know, it's a little Hollywood, but it's, you know,
based in reality. All right. Well, let me ask you, let's do this. So we have some questions, DZ, if we want to get the auxiliary cord open here. We have some questions from our hip-hop historian, Jay Kwan, who's one of the most scholarly and learned folks that I've ever met in hip-hop, period. He knows everything. So here's the first question, Davey, from our historian, Jay Kwan.
Yo, Davey D, what's going on? This is your man, Jay Kwan. Got a couple questions for you. The first one is, being a multi-instrumentalist, I know you play bass and you program drums and you play a couple instruments. What was it that got you into spinning records and doing something that was kind of frowned upon by other cats that play instruments? Who was it that you saw that made you say, okay, I want to be a DJ?
Well, I guess we got the answer to that one. That's June. You said Junebug.
Really? Yeah.
Right, so that's Junebug. All right, on to the next question.
My next question is the group Output. You know, you were part of a group called Output with Jerome Priester from Secret Weapon. A lot of people don't know that. They know you for your more hip-hop oriented stuff, but your Jerome Priester stuff had your signature sound. If you could just speak briefly about just about Output and how Output came together.
Okay, I got with Output as a guitar player, actually. And, you know, they were coming off of Must Be the Music, Secret Weapon. They had a problem with their management, so they had to change the name. So I got them and turned them into Output. We did a record, Say You Be. We had Yanni James. Yanni James was the voice for Run for the Trouble with a London accent.
Oh, hold on. Stop there for a second. Because that voice, let's be honest with ourselves, Davey. That voice is now so iconic.
Listen, man.
How did you find that girl? Who is she? Where is she from?
Her name is Yanni James.
Okay.
She was the singer for Secret Weapon, Output.
Oh.
So I had a concept of, because, you know, I kind of like Police. So I wanted my record to sound like it was an import.
So you got an English girl. She's English?
No.
Wait, so she put that accent on?
Yes.
Stop! You're ruining my childhood! That's not an English person.
Her MC name was Yanni Jay when she came out on the road with me, her and Sweet Tea.
Wow, my God. Okay, last question. You just totally burst my balloon. all right, here's the last question from our historian, Jay Kwan.
My last question. I was always a fan of Big Beat by Spoonie G. I think that's one of his better records, especially one of his better Tough City records. And again, it had your signature sound. What was your role in that record beyond programming the drum machine? Did you do everything on that record, or was it just the drum machine programming in the bass?
Did you do everything on the Spoonie G record?
Yes, I did. Everything but rap.
Well, speaking about doing everything but rap, we went back, you know, when you went solo, okay, and you released a single, One for the Treble, at a time when, I mean, releasing a DJ record, like, without a lead vocalist is maybe the craziest thing ever at the time. It was received really, really well. It was really received, like, people were kind of blown away by it. What, you know, among other things, the English voice, the girl, okay, we talked about that. But the car scratching, where does that come from? Where did, what made you want to do that?
We coming up as a DJ, like playing like a patty. So it was a zoop, 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 zoop. So that's how the intro started with One for the Trouble. This way, you know, I cut in Apache, you know, my intro for Apache, actually. And when I put the motorcycle over it, it just was incredible, man.
The motorcycle, and what is that motorcycle record? Just a sound effect?
Or? Burn Rubber by a Gap Band.
Oh, my God. I should have known that.
Yeah.
It was like peanut butter and jelly.
Spoonie G had another record called Street Girl as well on Tough City.
So what was it like? You know, Tough City is really one of the kind of, you know, early iconic, you know, hip-hop labels that put out some really, really iconic records. What was that like working with that label? I don't know a whole lot about the inner workings of Tough City.
It was just business, you know what I'm saying? It's pretty much, you know, I was learning the business, you know, along with, like, you know, going into studios and stuff like that. So it was a learning experience. I'll put it that way.
So were you, like, I'm just thinking about this, like, I'm an old DJ, right? And when, like, I didn't have this pleasure, but, like, when DJs went from carrying, you know, 800 pounds of crates to just carrying a computer, I'm sure, you know, whether we wanted to admit it or not, a lot of DJs were really, really happy. Were you, as a producer, really happy about not having to deal with drummers and setting up a drum?
I stopped DJing for 15 years because of that. it put me back in the game because I, you know.
But do you feel the drum machine was a similar effect? Do you feel like the Oberheim DMX drum machines and all the 808s, you know, all the drum machines that came out, do you feel like that was a kind of similar turning point in music to when, like, you know, drummers were no longer involved and now it was just drum machines?
Yeah, I mean, soon as drum machines came out, you know, they had something called a synclavier that the Musicians Union was boycotting pretty much because it was going to take everybody's job. And once that was opened up, because you could record cassettes and so on and so forth, and that's where the drum machine and computers came from.
Yeah.
Yeah, pretty much.
A lot of drummers lost their jobs.
It took people's jobs, kind of, but, you know, hey, because, you know, it's just like me as a producer, I need to be in the same room as the artist, because, you know, I'm not going back and forth. Like,
right.
I'm a producer record.
You could dare say that as many jobs that were lost because of drum machines,
it might have created
2 to 4 times as many, right?
Right.
Right? Because guys like you, I mean, are now iconic because of that. And even, you know, you get your name from that.
Yeah, but you didn't have to wait for musicians to come, you know, you could work. I mean, you know, you could always perform it live, you know, but, you know. Yeah, everybody don't walk around with a drummer.
Good point. So, you know, in your production career, and I'm purposely trying to go in order here, you know, then you started working with, you know, the Fat Boys because, you know, I guess Curtis Blow was producing for the Fat Boys.
Right.
Okay, yeah. And I was actually on the phone with...
We were a little team, you know.
Yeah, right. Right.
You got Jimmy Spicer...
Right.
Dollar Bill and the Bubble Bunch. So that, I'm just giving you, telling you about, still about action.
Oh, yeah. Well, no, the work you did for Jimmy Spicer, rest in peace, just recently passed away.
Yeah.
You know, he had a very small catalog of music, but every song that he had was so important, right?
Right. I did Dollar Bill and Bubble Bunch.
Right. And did you do all of the music on those records?
Yeah.
Wow. Wow. And those records have been
Larry Smith played the bass.
Okay. Okay. So with the Fat Boys, and I was just on the phone with Charlie Stettler, their old manager, earlier today,
right.
Who's going to be making a pretty amazing donation in their name to the Hip Hop Museum. You produced a few records, and when we had Kool Rock C on the show a couple months ago, we played the Jailhouse record that you produced. But today, because we've already played that one, we're going to play the music video for Hardcore Reggae because it cracks me the fuck up. All right? So
yes,
here's this next video. This is produced by Davy DMX, the Fat Boys. Davy DMX had his hand in everything that was hip-hop at this time, okay? And this is just the Fat Boys being one of the biggest acts in the world. Check out this hilarious video called Hardcore Reggae from the Fat Boys. The good, the fat, and the hungry. if anyone,
yeah. Let that happen.
But the poster in the background of one of the scenes, instead of the good, the bad, the ugly, it was the good, the fat, and the hungry.
Oh, wow.
Okay, so you are one of the most diverse musicians ever because, you know, if you listen to your work, I mean, that's an amazing reggae beat. You would have never known that, you know, had you made any other reggae songs before that?
Well, I'm looking for Shinehead.
Oh, right. Right. Oh, my God. I used to love Shinehead.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. And, you know, we're talking about very early. I guess we would call that kind of like ragamuffin.
Yeah.
You know, kind of like reggae hip hop. Early stuff when we started.
I call it reggae, man. I don't
differentiate. Right. It's all reggae to you. Yeah.
Right.
All right. Well, moving right along. Okay. Talk about producer credits. You also have writer credits, and you co-wrote Run's House, Beats to the Rhyme, and How Do You Do It, D, with Run DMC.
Yeah.
So tell me about, you know, your relationship with, you told me that, you know, you live next to Russell and you first met, you know, Run, but tell me about your relationship with them, in your words.
No, I mean, we all came up together, you know. So after DJing behind Curtis, when they came out with Suck MCs, they cut the record out to the bottom. I said to myself, like, I really didn't want to be, you know, I didn't need an MC really. So that's where the idea for One for the Trouble actually came from. Is I'll scratch my own MCs. I'll bring my own MCs in my crate. Yes.
I mean, he got distracted by his own music.
Yeah.
So tell me about, you know, like having one of the biggest singles in the entire country, Sucker MCs, you know, talk about Larry put me inside his Cadillac, you know, Dave cut the record down too. I mean, they're literally talking about, you know, Orange Crush and you guys are making the music. I mean, this is a very special time, and coincidentally, this is also what made me fall in love with hip-hop. Single-handedly, right. Run DMC. I'm from Brooklyn. I grew up in New York City. You know, hip-hop was everywhere. Hip-hop was everything. We would walk around with our linoleum under our arms so we could break dance. I mean, what we have a great clip, actually, of Run DMC performing Sucker MCs on a great show. But tell me, before we play the Sucker MCs, you know, what's that like, you know, being involved in Crush Groove and Run DMC and the music behind everything? Did it come out the way you wanted it to sound when you were making it in the studio?
Yeah, the thing about, like, in recording, I told this by the other day that, I mean, we never had to go, we made a record that night, and it was mixed the next day. Like, we didn't have to guess about none of it ever. And all the records wow. you made, you know, we never had to go back to the drawing board, so that was a kind of incredible formula there of people and you know, situations, yeah.
Do you remember the first time you heard one of your productions with Run DMC on TV or on the radio? Do you remember any of those times? Like when you first heard Sucker MCs?
Oh, yeah. I think it was a rap show back then. They never had like 24/7 hip-hop station, I don't think, back then.
Right.
So it was like more like shows, you know, so, yeah, you know.
Well, let's play one of those shows. We have a great performance of Run DMC performing Sucker MCs, and then Kool Moe Dee and Special K come out and go to battle them, like kind of a scripted battle after it on this TV show. Okay, so check this out. Here's a live performance produced by Davy D and Orange Crush. Check it out. Sucker MCs, Run DMC.
Cool. Yo, so what's up? What's your name?
Monique.
My name's Prince Vince.
Let me ask you something. Who's the freshest DJ MC crew around?
You know who.
Come on.
Who?
Jam Master J.
Run DMC.
To say some MC rhyme, so I said this rhyme I'm about to say. The rhyme was Def Jam Master J. Took a test to become an MC, and Orange Crush became amazed at me. So Larry put me inside his Cadillac. You see, the show went over, we never came back. And Jay cut the record down to the bone, and now they got me rocking on the microphone. Of them, we're talking autographs and tears and laughs, champagne, caviar, and bubble blast. You see, I'm best of life.
That's right, Dave did cut the record down to the bone. And if you're just tuning in, I'm Jeremy Beaver, CEO and founder of Listen Vision and the Hip Hop Museum, with my DJ, the one, the only,
B-Dub the Boy Wonder.
So, you know, the program we were just watching, you know, with the breakdancing and the live MCing, you know, the beginning of Sucker MCs is really iconic with the snares. Tell me, what made you want to program the pattern like that with all those snares in the beginning? They have since been used as a million different DJ routines.
Right. That's the exact way that action started.
So it's just mimicking the action pattern.
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's simple enough. I mean, they were so enamored with this one. You know, it's like a reggae track. You know, they had rhythms in reggae. And then they would do multiple vocals over this one rhythm, because that rhythm, that instrumental, is just so dope. That's that crushed groove rhythm was just so dope. Everybody kept doing a million different tracks on top of it.
Right.
Shit. Right. Well, okay, that's pretty simple. All right, let's get right.
I also produced "Bubble the World" from Curtis Blow on Curtis Soundtrack.
Oh yeah. Well, I mean, your work with Curtis Blow, I think it's safe to say, put you on the map, put you in everybody's radar, right? On everybody's short Rolodex.
But it's both on the map production-wise.
What influence did you get from working with Curtis Blow? Like, what was your biggest takeaway from working with him?
I mean, you know, it was like a dream come true, kind of, because, you know, going from the park to the garden. And then, you know, when we got into production, it just took it to another level. But, you know, still to this day, and doing my own documentary, I'm going to have Curtis be part of my soundtrack.
And so, do you kind of feel in a way that Curtis gave you your first big break, or do you feel someone even before that?
Well, I would say I feel more destined anyway, you know what I'm saying, to say, you know. Because, I mean, actually, you know, I think to myself that I had my own thing going, and you know, they came and kind of got me, you know what I mean? But
right.
I was on my way. I mean, I felt.
Well, you took some very, very specific steps, okay? So from musician to DJing to beat making and producing, Orange Crush and then Curtis, okay, and then becoming a producer, Spoonie G. And then it finally culminates with, you know, you being on Def Jam and having singles released on Def Jam. What was that like? Did it feel like you had finally really made it to the big time when you had records released on Def Jam?
Yeah, it was another pattern, you know, coming from Chump City to Def Jam. You know, it's just steps, man. I can't say it was really a better move because, you know, being in a small small lake, you get a little more attention, I would say.
Oh,
you
okay.
I'm not even sure how many they printed up, you know, so, you know, people have ideas for themselves and, you know, don't really kind of give you a chance. You know, I heard they just only pressed up 60,000 of records.
Oh, so right. That's maybe a good point. So at a time when, who were you kind of on the label competing with at that time? I know Jazzy J had a record out.
No, nobody. I mean...
You just felt like it was such an early days at Def Jam that they weren't able to give the big push that they were able to give, let's say, the Beastie Boys or LL?
Some people didn't, you know. I'm pretty sure Davy Rod album because it was kind of like, you know, right before the New Jack Swing, which, you know, I was swinging all the time. But, you know, what they call it, the New Jack Swing, you know, like working with Andre Rell, he kind of took that swing from kind of me, you know,
the swing pattern. So, you mean,
huh?
The pattern, the New Jack swing, I mean, pattern.
You know, a swing pattern. Yeah.
Well, let's play your lead single, which is like forever stuck in my head. In many hip hop, you know, Have You Seen Davy is one of the most catchiest songs. I don't know what it is about this track. I was listening to it all day today, reminded about how catchy it was. This is your lead single on Def Jam, Have You Seen Davy? So let's play it for the people. So, you know, we're getting short on time, and, you know, we are, it's interesting because I just looked at a piece of real estate today that may end up being the site for the permanent hip-hop museum here in Washington, D.C.
That'd be a big deal.
Very big deal. As you know, we've been a pop-up installation for our first 10 months as the world's first hip-hop museum. And don't get me wrong, I'm aware of, not naming names, but I'm aware of others that are trying to do this, you know, in New York or wherever. But I'm happy to report we're actually doing it. So, and we have done it. We have the collection. And my question is, Davy DMX, is there anything special in your collection, you know, in your music production life that you would like to donate to the museum to represent your music and career and legacy?
Yeah, we'll talk about that. I'm really hoping to be there when you get the building and open up and part of that ceremony as well.
Oh, well, there's no doubt you will have to be there. But I will follow up with you on Monday, as I always do, because I always get the same answer. Oh, okay,
yes,
I'll talk to you offline. I'll talk to you offline. And then I have to beg and grovel and plead, you know, for these incredibly... All I have to say is this one thing. To have a national hip-hop museum where hundreds of thousands and millions of patrons come to see and to learn and understand about your music and career, I think is going to be... you know, exactly what needs to happen. There's the credit. You know what I mean? There's the legacy, right? When people like Dr. Dre look at you DJing, or they look at your beat machine and they go, wait, I want to do that. That's what I want to do.
I set up my whole turntable with the DMX, and he said that they went out and bought the everything I had the next day.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Sure. So maybe what we're going to have to do is maybe put Dr. Dre's display next to your display.
Yeah, you know? I mean, yeah.
Okay, so people understand the connection there. And let me tell you, Davy, he's just one that mentioned it. You know how many hundreds, if not thousands, of other hugely successful artists absolutely can trace it back to you DJing or your beats or Run DMC or Fat Boys, Curtis Blow? They just probably don't realize it.
Right.
You know, but they could all trace it back. All right. But so
in time, you know, in I get time. To tell my own story.
Are there any little rare tidbits that you would, before we, you know, go, we're going to play your trailer here at the end, DZ, so cue that up. But is there anything that, you know, you're working on right now? You know, if people want to book you, if they want, you know, to get a track from you produced, you know, how can they get in touch with you and contact you?
DavyDMX000@AOL.com. Old school.
Okay. And are you still, if somebody hollered at you like, yo, I got to get a Davy DMX beat, would you oblige if the price is right?
Come on, man. Let's work it.
Okay. All right. Sounds good. All right. Well, tell them, just in closing, tell them a little bit about, you know, putting this documentary together and what people can expect, because we're going to close with the trailer.
Yeah. You know, I was going to let people know where I was born and, you know, and how I came up being a musician, then DJ, then musician, then the DJ for the thing. And hey, I'm still going forward, man, on it. You know, on just telling my story.
All right, Davy.
By the way, tell Dr. Dre holler at me, please.
we actually will, because, you know, we have a very interesting piece of his, which is the early Mercola Records satin jacket. If you remember the label Mercola Records, that he was first signed to, and we have his first record, and we have a bunch of crazy stuff in the museum, including the Death Row Records electric chair.
I would really like to see it.
Well, you know, I think it makes total sense to have you at the building's grand opening, and we're going to do a proper induction ceremony for you and give you the plaque that you so clearly deserve. But before I bid you adieu, is there any last words you'd like to say for all the young hip-hop fans out there looking to get into producing beats and DJing?
Keep it hip-hop. Keep it hip-hop.
That's what's up. Well, keep it hip-hop and keep it positive, you know what I mean?
Yes, sir, man.
So,
yes, sir.
Davy, I want to thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you.
I will give you a call on Monday, and right now, everybody, I would like to close out with the trailer from his documentary. Until next Friday at 5 p.m., I'm Jeremy Beaver, CEO and founder of Listen Vision and the Hip Hop Museum, with my DJ, the one, the only,
B-Dub the Boy Wonder.
Now check out Davy DMX's trailer for his new documentary. Peace.
Well, actually, Dave was one of the few people with equipment. And that's, there you go.
You know, One for the Trouble, when I found out that, you know, it was Davy's record, and that he was doing virtually everything on it, didn't surprise me.
Whoa, time out, bro. Davy D did Beats to the Rhymes and Run House. Yo, son.
We wish I didn't have that drum machine yet. Dude. I didn't have any equipment.
This is where I met Run DMC and Russell Simmons. I was doing this center right here, the after school center. 10 for the
best. Started realizing this Davy D is the same cat my brother was telling me about that had the little DJ crew that would DJ around Queens Village. 10 for the bass, 10 for the
bass. On the DMX drum machine and the scratches.
Come on, Davy D, let's rock this place.
No, I could have been one of the DJs.
Oh, you could have been a DJ?
Yeah, I could have been a DJ, but after Curtis Blow.
Sounds
So like to this day, I think about him every time like I'm on the road or we're driving somewhere.
Hey Google, play Have You Seen Davy?
Have You Seen Davy by Davy DMX? Sure.
I didn't know he played. He's a real musician.
Sounds like precursor to Beastie Boys shit.
I tried to play the guitar.
Doesn't it sound like a Beastie Boy record?
It was the flyest. I don't know if I can curse, but it was the flyest shit to me.
Then there was no real blueprint. There was no blueprint, so everything that they were doing was very innovative.
Davy is very unsung among producers and DJs.
But we all would wait for Dave to go to band practice so somebody could get on the turntables.
His business, his dad, a great man.
I remember Russell bringing me the Orange Crush, and I'm not sure if it said Dave's name on it or Dave had something to do with it, you know, or he played bass or something. I'm not sure exactly what it was. So I was like, I didn't know that Dave was even a musician, you know, like I thought he was just a DJ, you know.
As I think about it, you can say he's a rap version of Prince, but, you know, it's not like, you know, his personal presentation was very different from what Kurt was doing.
Hot dogs, pick it up.
The original DMX. Hot dogs, pick it up.
I don't know when I went on my first outdoor picnic, but I do remember.
When the Sixers are hot, everybody keeps telling me. Back when I had a part in my head in elementary. The 7s and 91, still Tyson's rape conviction. Mark bad times. I